there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours.
Julle kan so lank in julle Bybels na Matteus 14, Matthew 14. As julle soontoe wil blaai, dankie sê jy. As ons na Matteus 14 gaan kyk, from verse 22 of Matthew 14, Matteus 14 vanaf vers 22. Ons gaan 'n paar ander skrifgedeeltes aanhaal in die preek. Maar hierdie is die laaste in die reeks oor diepe waters. En die hele April is ons besig om te praat oor diepe water. Julle sal onthou dat ek in die begin van April vir julle uit Psalm 107 gepreek het en gesê, daar so vier verskillende storms wat die Here ons deurvat. Maar die storms het ons maar daarin, dis ook toevallig vers 22, die Here lei ons, daar's mense wat werk doen in skepe en die Here lei hulle na diepe waters toe. En dis in die diepe waters wat u die diepe werke, die wonderwerke van God kan beleef. En in elke situasie is die Here se doel in die storm, in die diepe water, om ons te kry by daai plek waar ons hom aanroep. And then we looked at the storms in our life that the Lord takes us through. And it was a privilege to go through the Red Sea together with the Israelites. And remember, the point of that was we need to not only get to the other side of the Red Sea ourselves after God has set us free and rid us of Egypt, but we have to get to the other side. And part of the sanctifying process of our lives, which many of us don't ever get to, we don't ever get to the point of total victory over sin because we're not prepared to see our sin lying dead on the seashore. Soos wat die Egiptiese leer, nie net is hulle vrygemaak, maar die vashou van die Egiptiese leer en die farao is doodgemaak in die geloofskruisiging van die Rooi See. And we need to see our sin dead. But in order to see our sin dead, we need to have that second faith experience. Not just that Jesus saves, but he sanctifies. He sets us free to live in victory, to lay off the old life. Om nie meer sondaar te wees. Daai liedjie van toekussentyd wat hulle sing, ek is 'n sondaar gered deur, I'm a savior saved by grace. Oh my soul. It sounds so good, but it's bad theology. Because God doesn't save sinners to keep them sinners. He saves sinners to set them free, to make them a holy people. A heilige volk. Hy red ons. Hy maak ons vry, sodat ons as gelowiges, nie as sondaars, kan dan leef. And I want to, last week we looked at a storm that broke out around the disciples. And remember I said to you, the scary thing about the storm last week is, they were in obedience. God said to them, let's get in the boat and let's go to the other side. You remember that? Okay. And Jesus, there were a number of boats, but it says they took Jesus just as he was onto their boat. So the point is, vat Jesus saam met jou. Moet hom nie los nie. Moenie laat iemand anders van hom getuig. Moenie laat iemand anders hulle geloof in jou lewe uitleef. Jy vat Jesus saam met jou, soos wat hy is. Not the way you want him to be, but the way he is, you put him on your boat. And if he falls asleep, that's okay. At least he's with you. Al slaap hy. 'n slapende Jesus op die skuit is beter as geen Jesus nie. Is dit nie so nie? And today I want to reach the climax of deep waters. And my sermon title is, He Walks on What We Fear. Hy loop op wat ons vrees. Kom ons lees dit saam. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat. He has a problem already for me. And he says to them, he made them get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side. Wait, now, whoa, deja vu. Last time you made us get in a boat and go to the other side, there was a storm. And we had the option to take you with. Now you're saying to us, pack up, get into the boat. What have they been busy doing? You haven't read it, let me tell you. He's just fed the 5,000 with some bread and some fish. And that's just the men that were there. So there were women and children. So it's at least 15,000 people that he fed. And he just made this huge miracle happen. A paar visies en brode, en hy het 15,000 mense kos gegee. Nou, as jy iemand is wat a journal hou, if you're someone who writes down in a journal, guess what? That's a journal day. As you get to the end of the day, what are you going to write in your journal? Wow. I don't know what word you're going to start with. Ongelooflik. I don't know. What are you going to write? He fed 15,000 people with a couple of fish and a couple of loaves of bread. No, man. No wonder. At the end of the day, listen to this. He made the disciples get into the boat. They didn't want to go. Wachno. Whoa. It was here. We picked up. So much leftover food. How do we even go? I mean, who cares if the sun doesn't come up tomorrow? We've now just seen something amazing. How do we? He says, hey, get into the boat. Come on, guys. Take your stuff. Take your minds. Go pick up the pieces of your mind that's been blown away. Just go pick it up. Find your socks that have been blown off. Put your socks on. Get into the boat. Go to the other side. And then it says, go of him to, while he sent the crowds away. You see, Jesus, at the end of this day, doesn't leave anything for them because they just, No, man, this is just too much. Get into the boat, go to the other side. I'll deal with the crowds. I'll send them away. Don't you worry. I'll pack up. Okay? Ons het nou piknik gehou. Gaan net huis toe. Ek sal skoon maak. Los alles net soos wat het is. Moenie die koppies soen toe vat nie. Nee, wag, ek sal. It's one of those kind of things. Jesus is wrapping up the day. After he had sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. Now, another portion of scripture tells us that Jesus is always, ever interceding on our behalf. So while he was praying, he wasn't just praying for himself, but he was praying for his disciples. He was praying for those who were getting in the boat. And he's up on the mountain, and the Sea of Galilee is 13 miles long, and at its widest, it's about 8 miles. So up on the mountain, you can see. And guess what? He's praying as they're going. And he's praying for them. And he's praying for himself. But he's alone. He's resting, recouping, and there's something for us. There's something for us in that. You need to make time to pray. You need to make time to draw near to God. Verse 24, but the boat was already a long distance from the land. Here it comes. Battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Nou is hulle besig om noordwes oor die see te gaan. En daar steek nou 'n suidelike wind op en dit blaas. En dis in hulle gesig en hulle roei en hulle roei en hulle roei en hulle roei en hulle sê neem oor, ek is moeg. En die volgende ou roei en hy roei en hy roei. Dis veronderstel om hulle so 2.5-3 ure te vat om aan die kant toe uit te kom. Okay? He sends them at the end of the day. He puts them in the boat and says, go to the other side. And in the fourth watch of the night, 9 hours later, 3 o'clock in the morning, roei, Jannie, roei. And they're still rowing at 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, let me just stop there and tell you. Sometimes it's uphill. But if you know you're in the will of the Lord, keep on rowing. Al is die wind van voor. Al is alles teen jou. As jy weet, jy's in die wil van die Here, hou aan rooi. What does the Lord say? Entrust this message, Timothy, to faithful men. To faithful men. Men who will remain faithful in times of adversity. Men who will carry on, carrying on, when things are not lekker. Wanneer dit nie lekker is nie. Moet jy aanhou. Hou aan, want jy weet, jy is bezig om gehoorsaam te wees, jy is bezig om in die wil van die Here te beweeg, moet nie twyfel nie, al is dit hoe moeilik, 9 ure, wat 'n 2 uur rit gou gewees het, hier is jy nog 9 ure aan die gang, en jy is nie eens naby aan die ander kant nie. Remain faithful, to what the Lord has asked you to do. He told them, he made the disciples get into the boat, and go ahead of him to the other side. Now they learned. I think they learned something from the previous storm. Remember what happened there? Waves, sea, wind. They go wake him up and they ask the wrongest question you can ever ask Jesus. Do you care that we are going to die? You don't ask Jesus that. We had a whole sermon on that. I don't have to remind you. You don't ask him, do you care? So I think they learned something. Okay, so I think in the darkness of the night, pitch black, rowing, wind, waves, we're not going to drown, we're just going to, come on, let's just, kom ons roei, kom ons hou aan. Ons gaan aan die ander kant uitkom. So they've learned something. They've grown a little bit. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. You see where I get my sermon title from? They feared that the water was going to drown them. And that which they feared, Jesus came walking on. What do you fear? What's your fear? What's your three top anxious thoughts? Only three, please. Just think about three. I know you got more. Don't brag now. Okay. Don't brag now. It's just limited. Everybody here just to three anxious thoughts. You know the ones you go to sleep with, you wake up with. Every time your mind goes into idle and you just sit in there, suddenly you find yourself thinking about that. You know those anxious thoughts? Oh, is it just me? No, none of you have got any anxious thoughts. How am I going to fix this relationship? How am I going to get the money to do what needs to be? How am I going to manage this in my life? How am I going to defeat? How am I going to get over this? What are people going to say when I reveal that this is? What's your anxious thoughts? What are you struggling with? What are you holding on to? That which you fear, Jesus has the ability to walk on. He has the ability to walk on it. He comes to them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were human beings. They were human. What does it say in your Bible? They were terrified. They were terrified. Naturally, in those days, people believed that the night spirits would bring harm to them. So they thought, you can read it for yourself, I'm not making it up. They were terrified and said, it's a ghost! And it's not Casper the friendly ghost. It's a ghost. Because you see, in our fear, we lose sight of what's real. We lose sight of the promises of God. We lose sight of God's presence in our life. You see, the last storm, Jesus was at least asleep on the boat. Now he'd sent them on their own. And my friends, even though you may feel alone, what was Jesus doing while he sent them out onto the sea? He was praying for them. Where's Jesus now? Seated at the right hand of God the Father, doing what? Interceding day and night, praying day and night. You pray for those that you see. And God has the ability, Jesus has the ability to see all of us at the same time. And guess what? Jesus pitches up in the storm at just the right time. Not your time, not my time, but at just the right time. You see, we start fearing before we get desperate. We start getting afraid before we get desperate. In Psalm 107, what did I say to you? The four storms that the Lord brings was to get them to realize that they'd reached the end of their ability. They had reached the end of their plans. And then they cried out to the Lord. In the storm on the boat, well, we're going to get to another fast prayer in a little while. In the storm on the boat when Jesus was asleep, remember I said to you, it wasn't, I'm not afraid, but you know, some of these guys here, they're a little bit fearful, they're not sure what's going to happen, so do you mind just maybe waking up and just having a chat with them? It wasn't that kind of conversation. It was like, they're kidding, are we going to die? Hello! That's this for bay Frias. This for bay Frias. This desperate, isn't it? Okay, cool. You're with me on this. It's a ghost. And they cried out in fear. In the midst of your storm, in the midst of your storm, are you holding on to the promises? And are you looking out for Jesus? Or in your fear, have you abandoned your faith? And you think even the ghosts are chasing me now. The devil is loose in my life. God's no longer in control. The devil has me. Immediately. Three times in this short passage, immediately happens. Immediately, immediately, immediately. We serve an immediate God. Immediately, Jesus spoke to them saying, do not fear. Do not fear, because fear clouds your vision. False evidence appearing real. Fear, F-E-A-R. False evidence appearing real. Dit lyk asof het waar is, maar is... It's false. And Jesus says, do not fear. Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. It's human. Listen to me. Listen to me. All deep awesome. Nog een keer. When the storm hits, it's okay to be afraid. It's okay to fear. You wouldn't be human if you didn't fear. Hello? Amen? Amen? Yeah. You wouldn't be human. But in your fear, take courage. Look out for Jesus. It is I is the same. It's ego ame. Ego ame. I am. It is me. I am. Remember when... when the brothers came to buy food from Joseph, who they sold into slavery, and they were worried and blah, 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 and they came back a second time, and eventually he clears the room and he's in tears and he reveals, takes the curtain off, and he comes and he says, "It's me." That's the Jesus who says, "I'm on your side, it's me." It's the one who says, when Moses is sent to lead the people and set them free, he says to the burning bush, he says to God, "If the people ask me who sent me, what am I to say?" Jesus says, or God says, "I am. It's me." Look for the Jesus who's going to come to you at the right time in your storm, reveal himself and say, "It's me. It's me." And that could be the end of the sermon if we want to stop there. But for Peter. Trouble on two legs. Like some of your sons and daughters. Trouble on two legs. Peter says, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." If it's you, command me to come to you on the water. And I've preached for a whole month to get to that line. Do you know that in Christ Jesus, we are more than conquerors? Ons is meer as oorwinnaars in Jesus Christus. Do you know that? Peter says to him, "Hello. The last time we woke you up, you calmed the storm and we were fine." That's old hat. Dis nie so opwindend meer nie. Don't do just that again. If it's you, let me come to you on the water. Christian, child of God, brother, sister in Christ, can I encourage you? As the storms hit in your life and it affects a number of people, someone has to stand up. Someone has to say, "Let's take charge. Let's take charge." South Africa, elections, everything that's happening this year, someone has to stand up and say, "Don't fear, take courage. The God I serve walks on that which I fear." Doesn't matter who gets into power. Doesn't matter who gets into power. Your worst fear can get into power. Remember who walks on them. Remember who walks on them. Remember who's ultimately in charge. And then it's not enough to just sit in your man-made security. "It's okay, Jesus, I'm glad you're here, but I've got my boat. I'm glad you're here, but I've got my bank balance. I'm glad you're here, but I've got my hope in this doctor and this medicine. I'm glad you're here, but I've got other friends in spite of that one that doesn't want to be my friend anymore. If I'm going to divorce my wife, wat sê die boere? Watch me next year. Hierdie oes was nie so goed nie, maar kyk, volgende jaar. Dis kom maar so baie kinders is. Hierdie een, kom ons skryf hom af. Ons het nog 'n oes. No, it's not like that. I'm rubbing it in. Ek vat dit te ver. Ek vat dit te ver. Okay. Maar hoor jy? Ek is bly jy's hier, maar hoe kan ek dit sê? Want hoeveel keer kom sit mense in my kantoor en dan praat hulle oor hulle huwelik, hulle praat oor hulle kind, hulle praat oor hulle man, hulle vrou, hulle praat oor hulle werk, hulle praat oor hulle omstandighede, hulle praat oor die finansies in die land en wat hulle vrees, hulle kom praat daar en dan vra hulle my wat sê die woord en ek sê so sê die woord, hulle sê ja maar. Hoe kan jy sê ja maar? As dit wat die woord sê, dan is dit mos so. Dis nie die woord plus wat jy dink. Hallo? Dis of die woord of is wat jy wil hê. Dis of God daag op en God kalm restoreer en God bring kalmte of jy bly jy klou vas. Listen. You know what's coming. Let me just say this. A wet Peter is far better than a dry Thomas. Give me a wet Peter every day to do life with over a dry Thomas. Come on, church. It's time to stand up. It's time to stop fearing the storm. Yes, Jesus can calm it. Jesus can bring calm, perfect calm. We said last week, perfect calm. But sometimes we need to walk in the storm. Baie keer met ons in ons vrees loop. Anderstens gaan hy nooit dood lê. Op die wal. You're never gonna have victory over sin if you don't walk over your sin. Sometimes you have to take sin and say, hey, nee, nie meer nie. Nou loop ek. Not sometimes, always. Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water. And he said, come. Come. Okay, it's one thing to ask, it's another thing to do. Lord, if it's you, let me come to you. That's Peter. He speaks without thinking. Jesus says, okay, come. He says, oh, hell. Sometimes we're so brave and we ask the Lord to give us the way to get through the storm. Not out of it, through the storm. But you must walk on that which you fear. Come. Left or right, which is my stronger foot? Okay, listen, guys. Just tie this rope around me quickly before I get into the... Imagine. But imagine the victory. Imagine what we... Come on. Their mind was already blown. When he fed 15,000, that's already a journal day. Now there's another storm. Oh hell, something to journal. I thought we were finished with storms. I thought we'd learned the lesson. And now he says, step on the water. Can you imagine? You know what I wanted to do? I wanted to fill a bucket with water and I wanted to put a log in there so that you didn't see the log. And I was going to step onto the water and you would think my foot would go in it and I'd actually stand on the bucket. But when I thought it through, I thought, you know what, my knee and going up like that, it's a big step and it might just, and so I didn't do it. But I really wanted to walk on water for you. But, and Kevin would have looked immediately. He was like, uh-uh. And then I thought maybe the log doesn't stay, you know, maybe it floats a little bit and if I stand on it, yeah. So I thought it through and I didn't do it for your sake and mine. Okay. But I'll work on it maybe for another sermon in the future. But when Peter stepped out of the boat, everything in you says, oh heck. And then there's that which isn't supposed to hold you pushes up and you push down and it's like it's not going anywhere. Can you believe this? Can you believe this? I mean, just think of it. This is water, guys. This is water. Good news. He walked on the water out of the boat and he came toward Jesus. Verse 30, but seeing the wind, he became frightened. You see, as soon as fear pitches up, as soon as we begin to get frightened, and it's rational, man. We mustn't moan at Peter here. Ons kan hom nie blam hier nie. Hy's wind nog steeds, hy's golwe. Hier loop ek op. Come on. As soon as he began to be frightened, he lost the presence of Jesus. And beginning to sink, he cried out, O Heavenly Father, who ordains all of life, O God, who knows my every yesterday, O God, who's so gracious and kind and loving and merciful, who forgives all my sins, and do you see that? Young, we can be so holy, young. Ons kan so heilig wees. Here moet daar sit en dink, hey, is nie nou tyd om wind op my te blaas, waar hy nie geblaas moet word nie. Is nie nou tyd om my te beïndruk met woorde. Lord, save me! Is genoeg. Lord, it's me, Peter. No, Lord, save me. And immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand, took hold of him and said to him, You of little faith, why did you doubt? Rarig? Excuse me, where's Thomas? Me of little faith? Kijk was ek, boet. Jy moet bykie met hulle gaan praat oor klein geloof. Ek's daarom hier op die water. But you see, so many people start with big faith. But again, what's it calls for? It calls for faithfulness. Faithfulness. Persevere in your faith. If you've stepped out in faith, keep your focus on Jesus. It's the same wind that drives some ships east and others west. It just depends on the set of their sails. Set your sails in Jesus. Set your sails in Jesus. Why did you doubt? When they got into the boat, check here. When they got into the boat, the wind stopped. And in Mark chapter 6, and in John chapter 6 and Mark chapter 4, the same account. It says, when Jesus got into the boat had reached the shore. Two miracles. The wind stopped and the boat moved. They'd been rowing for 9 hours. Their strength, their ability. They'd stayed in their security. They'd stayed in what they'd made. They stayed in what they were comfortable with, the boat. Peter gets out the boat. They get in the boat. The wind stops. The storm is gone. And they are at their destination. What we fear, he walks on. What we fear, he walks on. Get that picture in your head. When you pray for South Africa, when you pray for your marriage, when you pray for your children, when you pray for your parents and they need it, when you pray for friendships, when you pray for work circumstances, when you pray for the sports, when you pray for what you're praying for, those anxious thoughts, those three anxious, when you pray for them, help me see Jesus. Help me listen for his command in the storm. Because he's not just going to calm the storm. He's going to get me to do what I need to do in order to learn what I need to learn so that he can get me to the other side. And Jesus is the only one who will get you to the other side. getting back in the boat, Peter did the right thing. When he started sinking, he didn't shout to his buddies in the boat and say, "Hey, gooi het tou!" He said, "Jesus, save me. Jesus, save me." Let me give you this promise. Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6. Let me give you this promise. In the context of Hebrews 13, it says, "I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you." The writer of Hebrews is saying that's what God says to us. Jesus says to us, "I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you." And then he goes on to say, "So that we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What will man do to me? The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?" If that's not enough for you, Romans 8, verse 28 and 29. Romans 8, verse 28, 29. You know it. "And we know that God causes all things." God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purposes. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. God causes all things to work out for the good. What's that good? That you and I may be conformed to the likeness of his Son, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. Goes on to say, "What then shall we say to these things? What then shall we say to the storms in the life? What then shall we say to the doctor's report? What then shall we say to the bank manager phoning us and say they haven't got enough money in the bank, they need us to put some money into our account to help them get through the month? What do we say to all these things? If God is for us, what man shall be against us?" If God is for us, who can be against us? Okay. Three applications, I'm done. Closeness to Jesus doesn't equal faith. Naby aan Jesus, nie dieselfde as geloof nie. How can you say that, Sean? Sitting in church, sitting under preaching, doesn't equal faith. Faith is taking the truth of God's word and saying, "I'm willing to walk on it, even though I'm fearful, even though I'm afraid. I will stand on your promises." That's faith. Just knowing it isn't faith, it's knowledge. Living on that knowledge is faith. Just having Jesus near you is not faith. You need to believe and trust. He needs to be your focus, he needs to be your direction, and you need to be moving. What does James say? "Show me your faith, I'll show you my works." Faith without works? Second application, storms have three purposes. Storms have three purposes. A storm corrects, brings correction. Sometimes we're out of the will of God. Sometimes we've been willfully disobedient, and God uses a storm to correct us. Think of Jonah. Remember Jonah? God says, "Go." He says, "Sure." God says, "Hey, that way." Okay, storm, big fish, back here. Second chance. Jonah, that way. Okay. Sometimes the Lord uses storms to correct us. Sometimes the Lord uses storms to protect us. To protect us. Huh? Protect us. Sometimes the Lord uses storms to protect us. Think of Paul and the thorn in the flesh. He'd seen these visions. And he says, I've been sent a messenger from God, a messenger of Satan from God. And I've prayed 3 times that this thorn in the flesh be removed. And God said, my grace is enough for you. And by faith, he lived with a storm that kept him humble. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. He saw visions that other people didn't see. And he could get high and mighty, but what kept him humble? Die storm in sy lewe wat nie weggevat is nie. Ach nee, pastor, am I going to live with this until I die? If it's for your protection, his grace is sufficient. You see, that's faith in action. That's not, I've got Jesus, everything's kumbaya, my Lord, kumbaya, woo! Yeah, that's a dache plant of iets. That's not Jesus. That's not Jesus. Jesus gee oorwinning om op water te loop in die middel van 'n storm. En baie keer is die storm daar vir 'n lang duur om jou te beskerm van jouself geestelik. Thirdly, perfection. Storms are sent to perfect us, to take us into the likeness of Jesus. This storm strengthened the disciples and Peter, made him more like Jesus. Jesus, if that's you, let me come to you. If that's you walking on the water, I want to be like Jesus. I want to walk like an Egyptian. No, I want to walk like Jesus. Okay? We don't want to walk like Egyptians anymore. Dis slavernye en alles wat nie oorwinning is nie. Ons wil soos Jesus loop. So sometimes storms are there to perfect us, to make us like Jesus. There was a huge storm that was breaking. This is my last application. And these people were all on a boat. And the captain comes over the intercom and he says, listen guys, passengers, crew, we're heading into a terrible storm. We're heading into a huge storm. And it's going to be uncomfortable. You know, if you're in an airplane, I'll tell you to sit down and buckle up. But please go to your cabins and secure everything and hold on to the bed or the chair, or don't just walk around now. Go and get yourself into a safe area. We are heading into a huge storm. We're going into it. And the one woman, it had to be a woman. She got a message to the captain, I want to speak to you. And eventually, she didn't speak to the captain, but she spoke to one of the captain's aides. And she said, I just want to say to the captain, I just don't think it's a good idea to head into the storm. Why don't we just drop anchor here where we are before the storm, and let's just sit here and wait. And when the storm's gone, then we can go again. Okay? And the captain sent a message back that said 2 things. He said, and I think the person who gave it across, this first one, he said it very gently and respectfully. He said, Madam, the captain would like to remind you that he's in charge, not you. So trust him. And secondly, this boat was made with storms like this in mind. This boat was made with storms like this in mind. Can I say to you? Can I remind you respectfully? Jesus is the captain, not you. He's in control, not you. And let me remind you of this as well. When he died on the cross, he died with you and your storms and your sin and your choices and your circumstances in mind. And he trusted God enough to put you and me and everything about us on that cross. And God gave him the victory. So your and my Savior died knowing you completely, everything about you, your biggest sin. It's okay. He's a bigger Savior. Your biggest storm, jou grootste vrees, jou grootste vrees, het hy op die kruis oorwinning behaal. En hy loop op wat jy vrees. Don't drop anchor. Go with him into the storm. Father, thank you for the victory that's ours in the storms of life. Thank you that we can trust you, that when we have to make heavy, big decisions, when we have to make life-changing decisions and it creates a storm in our lives, it makes everything around us feel unshaky, and we question and we doubt and we second guess and we ask others for advice, and remind us to see Jesus coming, to look out for Jesus. Remind us to ask him to say to us, what's my next step? Not calm the storm, not take the storm away. What's my next step in the storm? Is it to walk on water with you? Tell me to come. Is it to sit in the boat? Tell me to sit. Is it to start swimming? Tell me to swim. But Lord, you tell me, what do I do next? In this, don't take the storm away, just tell me what I do next. And then, Lord, help us to keep our focus while we're doing what we know to do. Help us to keep our focus on Jesus. Help us to keep our focus on God. Help us to abandon that which is our safety, our comfort, if need be. Help us to put aside the title and the authority and the wealth or the lack of wealth. Help us to put aside the stories that we justify our living by. But I'm a fisherman, I know boats, and we're rather just going to carry on rowing. We've rowed for 9 hours, it's got us nowhere, but give us another 3 hours, maybe we'll make it. Lord, help us to truly have faith in you. Because South Africa, Groblersdal, Ben Viljoen, Julia Miller, the various workplaces, the plaza, Ormonds. Moeilik, moeilik. Groot uitdaging, storms wat woes is. Help ons as die kerk. Help ons as Christen mense die leiding te neem. Help ons om vir ander mense te draai, hulle in die oë te kyk en sê, moenie vrees nie. Wees bemoedig. God is vir ons. Wie kan teen ons wees? Ja, daar is 'n storm. Ja, dit lyk nie asof dit gaan eindig nie. Maar, jy, kyk daar. Jesus is met ons. Waar is jou geloof? Klein gelowige, kom stap saam met my. Daar waar jy sink, hy sal jou gryp. Maar kom ons loop saam. Kom ons staan op, kom ons beweeg vorentoe. Storms gaan nie weggaan nie. Dis 'n gegewe. Moenie verbaas wees as jy deur alle soorte beproewinge gereinig word, gesuiwer word. Maar Here, jy het getuienis gehoor vandag. Mense wat in 'n lang durende storm is, 'n siekte wat aanhou en nie wil weggaan nie, Finansiële druk wat lyk my daar kom net nie deurbraak nie. Verhoudings wat ek weet nie wat om in hierdie week anders te probeer as wat ek in die laaste 2 jaar, 5 jaar al met die vrou, die man ons omstandighede probeer. That's the reality of our life, Lord. We're human. We get fearsome. Remind us of your promises. Remind us of your presence. Remind us. So that we can live to your glory. And we can start walking with you on that which we fear. That which keeps us awake at night. Let's start walking on it. Father, I pray that from a pastor's heart, from a caring heart, for everyone in this room, for those in our valley, bring your presence, bring your grace, bring your mercy, bring your power. In Jesus' name. Amen. And you are mine.
Abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds.